Hi. This week we're talking meat, and it's the beginning of our butchers series. So who better to be with than Tim Wilson, butcher, farmer, and founder of the Ginger Pig Butchers Shops. Hi, Tim.
Morning.
Thanks so much for joining me. We're in your absolutely beautiful shop in Clapham, and I'm here to talk to you about what people should be asking their butchers when they come to buy meat. So the Ginger Pig has become one of the most respected and renowned butcher shops in London and in the UK, but you kind of fell into it by accident, didn't you? How did it all start for you?
Buying a derelict farmhouse, really. So I put the character back. I just bought some pigs. I bought some pigs, I bought some turkeys, I bought some chickens, I bought some geese. It was a total accident. I just sort of drifted into it. I knew nothing about butchering. But it was just a gradual, I enjoyed cooking. Then I found I could rear some animals, which were old-fashioned animals. I got into the animal side of it.
And very ahead of your time, really, because it's only more recently that we've started seeing people really returning to using their butchers. I think for the customer to be armed with a little bit of knowledge when they're going in to speak to their butcher will give them that confidence to feel like they're not going to get the wool pulled over their eyes, and to feel like they're going to be asking the right questions. What do you think, what are the sorts of things that people at home who are watching should be thinking about when they go to their butcher? What questions should they be asking?
First thing a customer should do is look at the counter. If you look down the counter and there are things like vacuum packed pieces of meat hidden away in the display, is there anything that looks a little bit suspect in there? You know, and then ask the butcher. Don't ask what's the best thing. You're going to get what the butcher thinks the best thing. If you look at lamb, think, is it spring? Now, traditionally, we didn't used to eat lamb in this Easter. Lambs are so sick because lambs are born at Easter. So we've changed our lambs around that consumers want to eat them.
Because they see them hopping about in the fields.
But they ain't ready, you know.
Yeah.
Now we lamb totally out of season, we lamb before Christmas. Mm. Just so that at Easter this year it's ready. Mm. Spring lamb will be very pale. You know, it's only 16 weeks old. The later on in the year we get, when the flavour actually improves, you know, as the lamb gets older, towards back end of the summer into the autumn, the meat will go darker, it'll go deeper redder colour. The fat will go slightly more yellow, but that's better flavour.
Right.
And then after Christmas, the lamb stops being called a lamb, it's called a hogget.
Hogget.
So your question to the butcher would be, well, you go in January, say, have you got hogget at the moment? Just, your butcher might think, well, actually, know a little bit.
They know a little bit about.
Yeah. Look for things like light fat. You know, if you want a steak, it needs a bit of fat around it.
Yeah.
If it's just a lump of meat, especially if the surface is very, very shiny.
Yeah.
Just imagine something covered in cling film at home. Mm-hmm. When you take the cling film off, the surface is always a shiny, sort of effervescent surface.
Yeah.
You've got a bit of meat in the counter and it's got a shiny finish to it and there's no fat. It could well be out of a vacuum pack. But again, if the piece of meat is has got the fat on it, if it looks nice and dry, chances are it's been cut there and then,
yeah.
which is what it should be. If you look at that piece of meat, you know that's going to eat well.
Yeah.
Because you've got the right colour, it's not too fiery. It's got lots of marbling. Everybody goes about marbling, but you know, you've got white streaks all over it inside there. Basically the fat, as it cooks, the fat runs away. Mm-hmm. So it's leaving little spaces in there. If it's just a big lump of meat, there's nothing, it's just a big lump of meat.
What about people like me, for example, who can't afford, sadly, to buy the big joints like that very often? I mean, I'm a big fan of the cheaper cuts. Do you think that there's something to be said for going to a butcher and asking them for the cheaper cuts?
Of course, yeah. That's, I mean, I think a lot of it is time. The cheaper cuts will take longer to cook.
Yeah.
People just sometimes don't think about it. They don't think, oh, I'll make a stew in the morning before I go to work, or even make it last thing at night and put it in the oven, turn the oven down low, and you can go and do it. I hope every butcher has got those cheap cuts. Of course, what some butchers do is think, well, I can't sell breast of lamb, so I'm just going to buy, I'll buy three shoulders, because I've got a few customers who buy the shoulders. I'll buy six pairs of legs, because the legs are the best bit. If you buy the whole animal, then you do have to as a butcher, you do have to get rid of the cheaper things. So for lamb, you know, breast of lamb, do you bone, get your butcher to bone you, he'll be annoyed, because the breast of lamb's £2. So it's going to take him 5 minutes to bone it out. But you get two breasts of lamb, £4. You bone it out, you get some lamb mince or some pork mince, make a stuffing, spread it between the two, roll them up, wrap it in cling film, poach it for an hour or two, and slice it into thick slices and grill it. You've got crunchy, lamby, stuffed breast of lamb. It's amazing. And it'll feed six people.
Yeah, and it's a bit of a wow dish as well.
Yeah, it looks great when it's done. So it's just thinking a little bit more.
The best
example in the world is chicken breast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
People walk into the butcher's shop and ask for two chicken breasts. The butcher's going to sell you the two chicken breasts, but built into it will be the rest of the chicken, because he doesn't want the legs and the thighs left over. So you're going to pay for the whole thing. So you better walk into the butcher's shop asking him for a chicken. Buy the chicken. Oh, and say, by the way, could you take the breast off for me?
Right.
And while you're at it, if you just bone out the two legs and the thighs, and I'll take two sausages and the carcass.
Yeah.
So you've got your two breasts. You've got your two chicken breasts to do whatever you're going to do with them. You've got your carcass, which is going to make stock.
Yeah.
Put the two sausages inside the boned out chicken legs, and so roast them, and you've got
delicious.
Great meals.
Or buy the whole carcass and have a go at taking the breast off yourself. Practice your butchery skills.
Practice your butchery skills, yeah.
Well, Tim, thank you so much for spending the time with us this morning and giving us some of your amazing insight into what we should be asking our butchers and what we should be looking out for when we're buying meat. I think that we're going to be hearing some more from Tim in the coming months. Hopefully we're going to be getting some seasonal recommendations from you. And I really hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have, please subscribe. Please leave us a comment if there's anything that you would like us to find out from people like Tim. And more importantly, make sure you're going to your butcher and buying your meat.